Anyway, with all that, let's turn in our Bibles to Romans 10, or on your app to Romans 10. Title of our study today, Our Righteous God. Paul shared his theme early on in chapter 1, where he said in verse 16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. And as we've walked up to this point in Romans, we've learned that God's judgment is always righteous because God is a righteous God. That God's judgment is merciful and just. And we see mercy and justice meeting at the cross of Jesus. We've learned that man by nature is unrighteous, and even spiritual people, often self-righteous, which is just another way to say unrighteous. There are those who do a lot of things the Bible says we should do and try to avoid doing those things it says not to do, but are still unrighteous. Why? Because righteousness doesn't come from doing or not doing. It comes from faith in Jesus. And then, of course, it's manifested in our efforts, but the efforts are always following his work for us and in us, not a prelude to it. So Jesus at one point said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. That would be like saying today, think of the most spiritual person you've ever met or know about, and him saying, hey, unless your righteousness exceeds theirs, you're never going to make it. Well, they were the most righteous people of their generation, except for one minor thing. Their righteousness was outward. It was for show. It was acting. Because Jesus said, outside, got a lot going, but inside, still dead, still corrupt, just like a tomb full of dead men's bones. So important to process this because, well, as we begin to walk with Jesus and grow in Jesus, there will be people that say, well, I've always known about him. I ask people, hey, so how did you come to the Lord? Or, well, if I first say, well, are you a Christian? If you ask people that question, they'll say all sorts of different responses. Yeah, I was baptized. And I'm like, as a baby, right? And they'll be like, yeah, how'd you know? Because the answer to are you a Christian isn't I was baptized. Baptism is a public testimony of something God had already done in your heart and your life when you believed in him and repented of sin, confessed him as Lord, and then publicly bore witness to that reality through baptism. So my point is this, a lot of people can say, well, I believe in Jesus. I believed in him my whole life, but I didn't become a Christian till I was in my late 20s. So anyway, a righteousness that exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees is actually easier to attain than you might imagine. They were trying to do it by their works, by their obedience to the law, by their ceremonial observances to things like circumcision and such. No, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. The righteousness we have was imparted to us and put on our account when we trusted in Jesus as Lord and Savior. Well, what shall we say then? We found back in, this is Romans 9:30, just to kind of give the bridge that gets us into chapter 10. What shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. That's how we were declared righteous by God, acceptable to him, accepted by him, in Christ Jesus. It's the righteousness that comes by faith in Jesus. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Because they did not seek it by faith but as it were by the works of the law, for they stumbled at that stumbling stone. It's interesting because Jesus is the rock of our salvation, but to the Jew who was trying to be justified by works or by law or by ceremonial observances, he was a stone of stumbling. Now, last thing I'll share, and we'll jump into the chapter, circumcision, and it'll come up, it was a sign and a seal of Abraham's faith. But that's after he believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. So we never want to substitute the sign or put the sign first, because then there's confusion over, well, how was I made acceptable to God? By putting faith in the one who bled and died for me on Calvary's cross. We can never add to or take away from the cross of Christ. That's ultimate perfection when it comes to our salvation. Well, chapter 10, then verse 1, Paul shares, as he did in chapter 9, his heart's desire for his own brethren, the Jews. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. For I bear them witness, they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Someone called zeal without knowledge, heat without light. And there are a lot of people who are just fired up and powered on, but they don't have light. They don't have wisdom. They don't have knowledge. Why? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And people can be very sure of themselves. I'm not so sure of myself. I'm only sure about Jesus. I'm not counting on what he did for me and what I've done for him since. I'm just counting on what he did for me. And that's all we can count on. We never add to what he did for us. We're simply responding in gratitude to him and reaching out to others for him because somebody did that for us. Well, in any case, their zeal reminded Paul of someone, well, he was real familiar with. The man inside, the guy he was before he came to Christ. He was ignorant of God's righteousness, and he was self-righteous, blinded by that self-righteousness and his need for forgiveness. It led to him persecuting people who put their faith in Jesus, as many do today. Verse 3 says, they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. The law basically said, do this and live, or don't do it and die. But the law never provided life. It never brought life. It simply said, here's how things are. Here's what God wants. And only Jesus was able to keep the law perfectly. Adam, by the way, an innocent man, the only other innocent man on planet Earth. He walked with God in the garden. He had a relationship, as did Eve, in the garden. And he sold us into sin by disobeying the Lord. Jesus is the only other innocent man. The difference between Adam and Jesus, Adam started out innocent and then he sinned. Jesus was tempted in all ways, yet without sin. Jesus always did those things that please the Father. So he kept God's word and law perfectly, and that enables him to pay the penalty for our sin, as the wages of sin is death. The picture and the idea is simple. I could never die for my kids' sins or my parents' sins or anyone else I cared for, my wife's sins, although she sins much less than me. But the point is, I couldn't die for their sins because I'm a sinner myself. I could die for my sins, and I would have had I not come to faith in Christ. So only a non-sinner can reconcile sinners to the Father And that's exactly what Jesus did for us. God in his grace and mercy says to us, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Verses 5-7 illustrate by pointing us back to Moses. It says in verse 5, Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law. The man who does these things shall live by them. Why? Well, that was in the law. God actually said, hey, if you keep it all, then you'll be fine. But if you break it, well, things aren't going to work out well. And so you should know, and most of you are aware, that Moses was the one chosen to go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go that they might worship me. Let my people go that they might serve me. Israel is my firstborn. Let my people go that they might walk with me. And Pharaoh basically said, that's not going to happen. And God, well, I like how God responds to somebody who just says flat out no to him. He could say, okay, well, have it your way. He didn't with Pharaoh, I'm glad. He didn't with Jonah, I'm glad. He shows us that if he wants to, he can say, no, I think we can work this out my way. And what does he do? He sends 10 plagues on Egypt, each of them attacking the false gods of Egypt. And each one more radical and more dramatic till you get to the 10th. And that was the plague that was a part of the Passover, the death of the firstborn in every household unless. And this is important. You'll see why in a moment. Unless you heard the word of God, believed the word of God, and obeyed the word of God. It wasn't enough to believe that God was telling the truth, that the firstborn was going to die. It wasn't enough to hear it and believe it. You had to actually obey it. What was the command? Take a lamb, slay it, apply the blood to the doorposts and lintels of your house. And when the death angel passes through, he will pass over. That's why it's called the Passover. So every household where the word was heard, believed, and obeyed saw the firstborn spared. Every household where that isn't what took place saw their firstborn die. Now, this is important because Israel's deliverance came by faith. They had to believe God for this to work for them, and it required God to be faithful to his word. And one thing I've learned in walking with him, well, it's been a while now, is that he's always faithful to his word. He's faithful to every promise, and he's faithful to every warning. He's faithful even when we're faithless. He cannot be made unfaithful. He cannot deny himself. So, in any case, we know that Israel put faith in God. They took a lamb, they slew the lamb, they applied the blood. That very night, well, he sent the plague and he delivered his people. Now, second thing is they were delivered before God gave them his law. That's important because that's true for us as well. Well, somebody might have said, you're a guilty sinner. And you're like, well, who are you to tell me that? He goes, former sinner, saved by grace. You know, those people that loved you enough to tell you the truth. And the point is this. He did give them the law, but not to save them. They were already saved. Not to deliver them. They were already delivered. He wanted them to know his will for them. And though he understood they would never keep it perfectly, lots of people did do their best to keep the law. What he never intended is for them to think, well, I'm keeping the law, so I must be fine with God. Because again, no one but Jesus ever kept the law perfectly. So the other issue, and there are actually two more. The law was like a sign saying salvation this way. And early on in my Christian walk, I started reading a guy named Ironsides. not the guy from the old sitcoms, if you're older, but a guy that was an evangelist and a very clear Bible teacher. J. Vernon McGee was familiar with him and others that I dearly love. But anyway, he had mentioned at one point that he never read the Bible or taught a Bible study without making sure he looked for the crossroad. And it stuck with me. So I've always found my way to the cross, no matter where we are in Scripture or what we're looking at, because, well, that's the core issue, is it not? The cross where Jesus died for our sins, was buried after and rose again. Without the cross, we would have been forever lost and separated from him. So not only do I look for the crossroad, but I was thinking about this whole thing. You come to the crossroad and there's a sign that says salvation this way. And it says, well, damnation this way. Only a fool would choose damnation. But you know what the Jews did? They got into the sign. They were looking at the law, which in our case would be the sign. And they were saying, isn't that glorious? Look at that sign. They started loving the sign and worshiping the sign. That's what they did with the law, you see. But the law was pointing to our need for salvation and pointing to the Savior. And all through Moses and all through the other who followed him, God kept giving testimony after testimony that nothing short of sacrifice of the shed blood of an innocent lamb would ever buy our salvation. So, fourth and final thing, and we'll get into verse 6, they were looking in that first century generation for another Moses. Now, God did say he was going to raise up another like Moses. What was Moses' mission? To deliver the people of God from the bondage that they were in under Pharaoh. In first century Israel was looking for someone to deliver them from the bondage of Caesar and of the Roman Empire and the corruption of it. But the problem was, God was trying to deliver them from the enemy within, not the enemy without. It would have been easy to kill Caesar, but there would have just been the next guy. Actually, those guys usually took each other out. It's a long line of some strange ways that people came to power and lost it, often being killed by their own kids or by the next guy in line. But all of that to say, that they wanted Rome to be crushed, which, by the way, the scriptures in the Old Testament describe a time, and we touched on this recently, where peace and prosperity would cover the earth, where Jesus would rule and reign in righteousness. And what they wanted was for that to start then and there. And that's what the disciples themselves were about. They're like, are you now going to establish the kingdom? Is this it? Are we going to get going? And he would say things to them, like in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who followed me will sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And then they're all excited and they're like, well, let's get that going. Let's get us on those thrones. Let's establish the kingdom. Let's crush Rome. The problem was, Jesus came to suffer and die the first time, not to rule and reign. And he is coming again, and all of those prophecies will be fulfilled. We'll see next time, as we get to look into the faithfulness of God, that Israel not only promised restoration in the last days, but those disciples and that nation, a huge part of the coming kingdom, where Jesus literally rules and reigns from Jerusalem over the entire earth. All of that is second coming stuff. So anyway, God wanted to deal with their corruption, with their sin within. That's what Jesus came to deal with, to pay the penalty for it, to reconcile those people to him. We're among them. Well, the verse that follows, verse 6 says, but the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That's to bring Christ down from above. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. Now listen, it's just saying the salvation offered to you, it's not way up there or way down there. It's not in heaven. It's not in Hades. Jesus came down from heaven, lived among us, died for us, went and preached to those who had died in faith, looking forward to the coming of a Savior, a Messiah, the one promised to them. And listen, then he rose again. Since that time, no one who dies knowing Jesus on this side of the cross goes to any waiting place or temporary situation, absent from the body, Paul will write, present with the Lord. That's what we have to look forward to. The moment we breathe our last here, we open our eyes in the presence of God. Now, if you're not in Christ Jesus, that's not what's going to happen to you. And I will always say again, man, if you haven't given your life to him, do it today. Because this is God's plan for your salvation. It's plan A, and there is no plan B. In any case, all of this comes out of earlier prophecies and earlier instruction. Back in Deuteronomy, God made it clear that the word wasn't far up there or far down there. Listen, Deuteronomy 6:6 says, these words I command you today shall be in your heart. So that's where he wants the truth of his word planted. These words, the words of God in our hearts, and you shall teach them diligently to your children. That means formal instruction, regular instruction. And that you shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way, when you lie down and rise up. That's just conversational instruction. Something happens, you say, hey, this is exactly what that devotion was saying. This is exactly what we were looking at in the scripture last time we did that together. It says, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand. They'll be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. The two most important words in all that is the word heart. And then the word teach, because the heart believes and the mouth confesses. And we're going to see that as we continue in the passage. Two other Old Testament references will come up. Second one, Jeremiah 31:33. This is the covenant I'll make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I'll put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they will be my people. 2 Corinthians 3:3, this is out a ways, but we'll come to it in some months. Paul says, clearly you are an epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, as was the law, but on tablets of flesh, that is of the heart. So what he's saying is, the word that saves, the word that secures, it's not far away up there and it's not far away down there. It's literally in our hearts and in our own mouths as we proclaim it to be true. Today, Paul will write elsewhere. Actually, if he wrote Hebrews, that's a road we don't need to go down. But today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. As they did in the rebellion in the day of trial, respond to his invitation, take hold of his promises, experience that radical transformation. Well, what does it say, verse 8, ask here in our passage? The word is near you in your mouth, in your heart, the word of faith which we preach, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised them from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. The heart reasons and the mouth responds, that testifies and bears witness to what's happened within. That's why Jesus says at one point, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So, he mentions with the mouth, confession is made to salvation. The word confess is oh so important to us today, because it doesn't just mean to acknowledge you're guilty, to say, yeah, okay, I did it. Okay, I'm a sinner. To confess means to say everything God says about man, about God, about sin, about separation, about regeneration. It's all true. To confess Jesus is to say everything the Bible says about Jesus is true. And everything Jesus said is true. So today we have people who say they're Christians and only God can see the heart, but they don't believe in the virgin birth. Or they don't believe in the bodily resurrection. And they're like, does it really matter? I think it does. Jesus said he would die, that he would be buried and rise again. As Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. He promised he'd be back. And well, it matters. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Does that matter? It does if people are trusting in anyone but Jesus or anything but his finished work on the cross to make themselves right with God and acceptable to God. It's essential that we pass this on, because there are millions of people claiming Christ's name and claiming a relationship with God. And listen, I'm of the mind that you can just hear the gospel and respond to it and truly be saved and forgiven all your sin. But as you begin to read the Bible to say, well, I don't agree with that. Well, I'm not going to stop doing that. I'm going to keep doing this. That's not a good option for a believer in Christ. It's living like we don't believe, or like Jesus isn't who he claimed to be. At one point, he just says, unless you believe I am, you will die in your sin. Verse 11 says, the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. There are a few things here in this chapter in Romans that you've probably heard. Well, if you've been here a while, you've heard them a lot. But it's calling on him, trusting in him. As the thief on the cross who repented, not the one who refused to, but the one who actually did, confessed that he deserved what he was getting. Actually, he included his buddy. We deserve this penalty. We're guilty. But this man's innocent. He confessed his guilt, Jesus' innocence. Then he said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. How much more would be required for somebody to be saved and assured that they would be with him? He said, hey, today you will be with me in paradise. All it took was him putting faith in Jesus. And that's all it's ever taken or will take. He never had an opportunity to tell other people, but we're telling the story, so it's being shared. He never had an opportunity to be baptized. He never had an opportunity to do good works or to obey the law. All of that was impossible for him, but he was still acceptable to God. And that's the message we need to get to people, that in Christ Jesus, there's forgiveness. And he says to the Jew and the Greek, that's all there were in their minds. There were the Jews, Israel, and then there was the Gentiles, the Greeks, and this particular thing. So whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's true for the Jew, for the Greek, and true for you. How then shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring good tidings, glad tidings of good things. Listen, the questions he's asking are important because he's laying out what has to happen for the world to hear the message. Our vision and mission statement says we're all about winning the lost to Christ, discipling the saved for Christ, and sending out equipped workers to represent Christ. That's exactly what this is saying here. It's saying, how are they going to hear unless somebody preaches? And how are they going to preach unless, well, somebody sends them? So it starts with us believing, being discipled, growing in the word and in grace, and then being sent out. And listen, don't imagine sent out always means somewhere far away and foreign. No, you know where there are hundreds of thousands of people that need the gospel and need the hope we have in Christ, the peace we have in Christ? Butte County, and then the county surrounding, Glenn and the others who are all around us. Thousands of people who are hurting and needy, and they don't even know that Jesus is the answer, but we know. And so I am telling you, this is the process. You just reverse what he has to say, that you go and you share, and when you share, then people believe. And when they believe, well, they'll call on him. Messengers, by the way, ran in those days. So when it talks about the beautiful feet, it's like you see the dust and, you know, then you notice the feet. I'm not sure they mean every messenger of God has beautiful feet, literally. I know at least one that doesn't. But this idea of bringing good news. By the way, if you want bad news, all you have to do is watch the news or read the news. If you want good news, I'd encourage you to read your Bible. Even the stuff you don't understand will benefit you and bless you as you gain understanding. And then he goes on to say in verses 16 and 17, they've not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The word that's in our hearts is spoken by us, it's heard and believed, and that work continues generation after generation after generation. But I say, verse 18, have they not heard? Yes, indeed, their sound has gone out to all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. Here he's quoting from Psalm 19, verse 4, referring to nature's testimony that's heard everywhere, at all times. The very creation itself is crying out saying, hey, I'm here and all this is mine. But I say, verse 19, did Israel not know? First, Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy by those who are not a nation. I will move you to anger by a foolish nation. He'll be even clearer on this when we get into 1 Corinthians, but this is important. Track with it. Israel considered those not of them inferior, insignificant, even unworthy, though all are unworthy of God's blessings. That's why it's grace. It's saved by grace through faith. Nobody earns it or deserves it. We just believe and accept it, or people don't believe and reject it. But he says, I'm going to move you to anger by a foolish nation. He's talking about the people of the Gentiles, of which most of us are descendants. And when we get into Corinthians, he's going to mention that not many wise were chosen, not many wealthy were chosen, not many powerful were chosen, but he's chosen the foolish things of the world. He's chosen those who are not to deal with the foolishness of the wisdom of people who thought they were something. And so he takes the people they despised and said, I'm going to use them to show you what you really need. Not just my law, not just my temple, not just the priesthood, not just the feast, not just the festivals, not just the sacrifices, because all of that was to bring them to faith in him, point to their need for his forgiveness. And so Isaiah just says, verse 20, I was found by those who didn't seek me. I was made manifest to those who did not ask for me. That's us. And I want to say that's true for you. It's true for me. I know that some of you came to the Lord during that season where the whole seeker-friendly thing was really big. And the idea was, well, you know, people are seeking God, but all the talk of sin and blood and the cross and judgment, people are offended by that. They don't like it. So some were saying, we need to do less of that. Don't sing about it and don't talk about it. I would be useless if I wasn't talking about those things, because there's no way for anybody to find forgiveness except to know they're sinners and that only the blood of Christ can cleanse us from our sin. So the good news here is, when we weren't seeking him, he was seeking us. That's the point he's really making. He wasn't hiding from us. He wasn't, you know, hoping we'd find him. He reached out to us. He loved on us. He was providing for us. And then he revealed to us that, hey, I'm the one taking care of you. I'm the one keeping you alive. I'm the one who has everlasting life in mind for you. So the bottom line is, Paul here is recalling something from Isaiah. In fact, this verse and the one that follows tracks with Isaiah 65:1-2. Isaiah 65 says, I was sought by those who did not ask for me. I was found by those who did not seek me. Here I am to a nation not called by my name. It's a warning, though, to those who are putting their faith anywhere but in him. And it's a warning to those who say, well, I do believe in Jesus, but they've turned from him. They've turned from the truth. They're not walking in the light. They're not walking in truth. They're not walking by faith. They're not walking in obedience. Anyone can say, I believe in Jesus. 1 John, and you should go read through it. It's the smaller John, you know, not the great big one. It's the smaller one later on, where he says, if we say this, or if you say this, well, you just got to check it out, because the things he cites are things people are saying. And in any case, where that leads us is that he goes on to say, and this comes from Isaiah 65:2, I've stretched out my hands all day long to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good according to their own thoughts. Here's what's happening. Bible tells us in the last days there will be a mass apostasy. People who claim to have faith in Christ will turn from that faith and embrace lies. And that we see happening around us. So how do we deal with it? Well, we're to love on them and speak to them and pray for them and to do good, because he's still reaching out to those who are alienated from him. To Israel, he says here in verse 21, all day long I've stretched out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. I want to say many who weren't looking, and that was us, we found the Lord. Those who claim to know him, well, like Paul, they persecute the ones who actually know him. But God got a hold of Paul, and Paul is you know, laying it out for us. By the way, hope for the one who's not seeking. Just pray for them. If you have family members who you know, they're just like, not interested, it's not really my thing, I'm glad you have it, happy for you. Listen, just pray for them and trust that God will make an appointment with them. He might even use you to do it. But he'll use someone in some situation to get their attention. He did it with us, so he can do it with them. There is a warning, though, to those who say I believe but don't live as if it's true, those who say, well, yeah, I'm already a Christian. Why would I need to give my life to Christ? Well, listen to Jesus, because he pretty much has it all nailed, right? Matthew 7:21, I'll give you two scriptures. We'll pray and we'll worship together. Jesus says in Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, done many wonders in your name? And I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. How can they say, Lord, we did this and this and this in your name? And he says, well, I don't even know you. Of course, he knows who they are. He's God, right? He knows everyone and everything. What he's saying is, I never knew you like that. They're saying not just Lord, but Lord, Lord, to emphasize the relationship. And they're saying, Lord, Lord, and they're saying, Lord, Lord, but they're not saying, Lord, thank you for loving me. Thank you for dying for me. Thank you for giving me life. Thank you for transforming my life. No, they're saying, Lord, Lord, didn't we? And Lord, Lord, didn't we? And Lord, Lord, didn't we? They're pointing to themselves as if their works should be acceptable to him. And he calls those works lawlessness. How can that be? Because they weren't done in obedience to him at his bidding, nor were they done to glorify him. He says, I never knew you, because he never knew them as their Lord. He is the Lord, but they never submitted to his lordship. Therefore, Jesus concludes, and I will as well, and this is Matthew 7:24, if you want to jot it or look at it. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended and the floods came and the wind blew and beat on that house and it fell, and great was its fall. Listen, the storm we're in will not be our last. But Jesus is the rock of our salvation, and his word, a sure foundation. Lord, we are grateful today that you are a sovereign, merciful God, as we considered last time. And you are a righteous God who always does what's right. And Lord, next time we'll get to see it. A faithful God. We already have found you to be that. And Lord, I want to pray for my brothers and sisters, everyone gathered here, everyone listening in or logged on. I pray that every heart would be encouraged today, reminded today that it's never been about what we've done for you. It's always been about what you've done for us. It's never been about our affirmations of faith in you or love for you. It's always been about your faithfulness to us and your love for us. And when we stand before you, Lord, it won't be what you did for us plus whatever good we did or whatever we gave up and stopped doing. It will just be you. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. We do believe in you. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We hear it, we believe it, our heart wells up within us, and our mouth confesses that you are our Savior, the true and living God, mankind's only hope. And if you're here today and you know these things, man, just make sure you share them with somebody this week. Just say, Lord, make me a divine appointment and make it so clear when it happens that I'm like, oh, this is it. So I can share the love I have for you and the gratitude I feel toward you. So those who need to hear will hear. Send me. Send me. And if you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus, gathered here, logged on, listening in, today is the day of salvation. We come to the crossroad and we don't just see a sign. We see Jesus crucified on the cross for our sins, died there for our sins, buried, and rose again. Forgiveness and life eternal, life everlasting is in him. Life abundant now and everlasting life. Wherever he is, we will be, and we will be with him. So listen, if you've never given your life to him and you want to do that right now, I'd ask you to raise your hand, hold it high, get my attention so I can pray for you. Awesome sister, I see your hand there. We're going to pray with you in just a moment. Anyone else want to say yes right now, right here? I want to surrender to the one who gave his life for me, who died for my sin, who was buried and rose again. Awesome, I see your hand there as well. Wonderful. Anyone else want to join these two and say, me too, right here, right now? I don't want to go another moment without knowing that I know Jesus in a real and life-transforming way. Anybody else? And then we're going to pray. Can't see you if you're listening in or logged on, but the Lord does. Pray these words aloud after me, and believers, feel free to pray them aloud as well. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die for my sin. And I believe he did, that he was buried, that he rose again. He gave his life for me so I could live my life for you and that I could be with you forever. And Lord, I want the life he made possible and that I'm hearing of today. I give you my life. Seal me, fill me, transform me, and use me to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, let's welcome these sisters and anyone else who prayed that prayer into the family. We have a Bible for you. Please come up when we're all done here. Let us meet with you and just get a Bible to you. It's a little pocket Bible. It'll get you started. If you know others who've made commitments to Christ and you realize they don't have a Bible, we want to make sure everybody gets one. If you're logged on or listening in, should be hearing or seeing how you can reach us so we can make sure someone gets to you wherever you are and gets a Bible to you. Welcome to the family of God. Let's stand for one last song together.